2 Samuel, let's get chapter 11. 2 Samuel chapter 11, and this is our final service together as a church in the year 2014. And frankly, I can't believe how fast it's gone by. I can honestly say that this year's went by faster than any year of my life in my mind. I can't remember another year that has went by so quickly, but it's been a good year. Been answered prayers, been through the Bible a few more times, and a lot of things that I wanted to be more involved in. Didn't get the time, but the Lord did provide other opportunities. We saw people saved. It's been a good year for the church. Just went by way too fast. You know, the Bible says life is a vapor and defines life as a little time. And if we waste our time, folks, we're wasting our lives. And someone once observed that a wasted life is really nothing more than a collection of wasted days. As God gives us life, He has also blessed us with opportunities. Every one of us had the same opportunities in front of us. 365 days that we can choose to just let them go by and just drift away from us for nothing and not, or we can invest those days towards something eternal and something that God will reward at the judgment seat of Christ. And the difference won't be in talent and skill. The difference will be in diligence and faithfulness. That's the way it works. Now, coming up is a new year. 2015 is unspoiled in the book of time for us. It's the opportunity to practice many of the lessons that we learned in the last 12 months, and much of what we sought for and wasn't able to do and accomplish last year, we may be able to pull it off this year. But God said, I make all things new, and He has given us a new year, and we can't determine the circumstances. We don't know what the circumstances will be for next year, what the situations will be. We have no power in how to bring those things about, but we do have a say-so in what the attitude of our heart will be and the level of our faith, and whether or not we'll walk with God, regardless of the circumstances, we do have a say-so in all that. The character of the new man that God has created in us through the new birth is one of light. That's the nature of the new man. We're children of the day, not of the night. And as the Bible tells us that in 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 6, He says, therefore let us not sleep as do others, but let us watch and be sober, for they that sleep in the night, and they that be drunken are drunken in the night. And the thought is to just stay in character, not walk after the flesh, which is completely a different character. It's living for nighttime and being a part of the world. We're acting like we're children of the night. And the truth is, we're not children of the night. We're children of the day. And in the Bible, we see examples of this happening where good men and good women get out of character. We could go through any number of examples tonight. We can start with Abraham, the father of faith, who has a lapse in faith due to the fear of man. And he begins to mislead people about the relationship or the nature of the relationship he has with Sarah. And there's a lapse in judgment there. He's out of character when that happens. Moses is the meekest man in all the earth. That means he's under control. There's a remarkable temperament there that Moses has. But there comes a day and time where he's had enough. And a spring pops and he begins to lose it. And he begins to shout and scream at the people. And he's whacks that rock when he's supposed to speak to it. When he does that, he's no longer meek at that point. This is the meekest man in all the earth. He loses his meekness at a moment. He's out of character when that happens. But perhaps the greatest example of this is David, whom we learn from the Scripture is a man after God's own heart, and having read through many of the Psalms that God used him to write, I have no trouble believing that. He loves God. He fears God. He wants to serve God. But he's a good man. Good man living a good life. God testifies that he's a good man who lived a good life. But that being said, David was not a sinless man, and he didn't live a sinless life. David did mess up, as good as he was. And keep in mind, I'm talking about somebody the Holy Spirit uses as a standard for a lot of other people that will come to follow him. He'll talk about his servant David and how he served him. As good as David was, he became guilty of things that are as low down and vile as a man can be guilty of. We're talking about David. He takes a wrong turn and he goes a good while down a wrong road until he hits that wall of someone giving him the Word of God. And he responds to it. Now, in order to prevent you from having a bad year, I'm looking at this event in the life of David, the king, an event that's familiar to most every one of us in here. It's tragic in the life of David. It cost him. It occurred there. It took him from an entire year. I mean, it takes an entire year from him, and then he suffers for what happens in that year the rest of his life. Not that he's not able to walk with God anymore. Not that he's not able to be right with God anymore. He is. But he suffers. He suffers for what happened on this night. And what I'm preaching about tonight is a bad year for a good man. And he's out of character. Now, in the context, speaking of David's lapse of moral judgment, his immorality, the display of weakness and wickedness, David has said, every man at his best state is altogether vanity. And he proves so much to us about himself. He's guilty of adultery. And then a bloody conspiracy that leads to the loss of innocent life, and then the blasphemy of God's enemies against the Lord and His people. And notice as this passage speaks to this sinful tragedy, 2 Samuel chapter 11 verse 1, it says, "And it came to pass, after the year was expired, at the time when kings go forth to battle, that David sent Joab and his servants with him and all Israel, and they destroyed the children of Ammon and besieged Rabbah. But David tarried still at Jerusalem. And it came to pass in eventide that David arose from off his bed and walked upon the roof of the king's house. And from the roof he saw a woman washing herself, and the woman was very beautiful to look upon." And of course, the rest of the story is infamous, and it's disastrous. What follows is the fall of a hero, someone who loses their testimony and loses their closeness to God, and in the scandalous actions of his own lust and incontinency, even after all that, he's still able to act as if he's above it all. He's done nothing wrong. But notice the story begins, quote, it says, "After the year was expired." So this is the beginning of a new year in the Bible. And we can all agree it was a very bad beginning of a new year for David. And had David known the trouble he was bringing to himself, to the kingdom, and to his house, of all, what he was going to sow that night, I'm sure he would have done things differently there. But in one night, a very bad year began in the life of this one that we know from the Bible to be a very good man. Now, 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 11 says this, "Now all these things happened unto them for examples, and they're written for our admonition, upon whom the ends of the world are come." Listen, "Wherefore let him that thinketh he standeth take heed, lest he fall. There hath no temptation taken you, but such as is common to man. But God is faithful, who will not suffer you to be tempted above that you're able, but will with the temptation make a way to escape, that ye may be able to bear it." That is, all this is recorded for what? God's not putting out a gossip sheet tonight, showing us the dirt on David for no reason. He's trying to help us learn by David's mistakes. And David, as good a man as he was, he made some big whopping mistakes. I love David. All Bible believers do. He's clearly a man of faith. He's a man of pure motive. And I take no pleasure in preaching about this event in his life tonight. But I do so because I believe that there's some things we can learn from it. Some things that'll help us. Because if a man like David, with a heart like he had, can get all messed up, folks, you and I aren't above it. Amen. And we better look at this book, amen, realize here's a man who's a father, he's a king, he's a husband, amen. I mean, this is a saint of God making terrible mistakes that he bears the consequences of the rest of his life. Someone asked, well, how could that ever happen to me? How could it happen to David? I mean, think about it, folks. Bob Jones Jr. used to say this, "Every tragedy in human character is the result of a long process of wicked thinking." And the point he's trying to make there is that old giant, you know, redwood tree there that's fallen in the forest there, some of those trees are so large they drive right through them. They build a highway through them. They get out there and there's one laying on the ground. Someone says, "What? But that was a whopping storm that took that tree down." No, it wasn't a storm that took that tree down. Something from the inside for years before was working from within that tree to fell that tree. Or something at the very root of that thing was killing that tree, and at the right moment, that big giant tree fell down at a moment, but it wasn't the moment that caused it to fall. It was what's been going on either at the root or within for years. And folks, that's where we got to be careful, amen. A man doesn't become unfaithful to his wife in a night's time. There's something going wrong for a while. A woman doesn't fall in love with another man and their marriage is over in a night's time. There's something within that's going wrong. And people got to get on track. Every tragedy in human character is the result of a long process of wicked thinking. Listen, this thing that happened to David happened in a night, but not just because of the one night he was out of place. The fact is he was out of place. There was somewhere else he was expected to be and he wasn't there. And that's not why he fell. It gave opportunity for him to fall. But there was other things going on even before then. Men that are keeping up with their walk with God and maintaining their heart and their devotions toward God, men that their heart is set towards the Lord, they don't do what David did. You understand? Doesn't happen to them. Sin doesn't just fall on us. And we don't just fall into sin. Usually we think about it, and we think about it, and we think about it, and then we dive headlong into it. And it doesn't just happen, friend. It happens because people have been thinking the wrong way for a long time. Someone says, how could this happen to me? Just like it happened to David. The Bible says in James 1:13, let no man say when he's tempted, I'm tempted of God. For God cannot be tempted with evil, neither tempteth he any man. But every man, listen, this you, me, and all our kinfolk, every man is tempted when he's drawn away of his own lust and enticed. Then when lust hath conceived, it bring forth sin, and sin, when it's finished, bring forth death. Now we're coming up on a new year, and for me, a new year's an exciting time. I like new year. I do. I love it. It's kind of like my birthday. I don't like getting older, but it helps me because, see, you wouldn't know it, but I do have plans. I don't seem to be super organized, but I have an idea what I want to do in a day's time. I have an idea what I want to do in a week's time and in a month's time and so forth, and I try to stick with those things and how much I want to be, where I want to be in my Bible reading, all that stuff. Those are things I make plans there. And so what I've been doing is I've been sitting down with an organizer and getting ready for the new year, making plans. And it's not dreaming plans. I do this every year and it helps me. And in the course of a year, eventually you begin to kind of slag back and something happens and you can't do all that you plan to do and you're getting behind. And then whop, it's my birthday. And on my birthday, I get to start all over. I have almost 2 years, you understand? I'm nobody that works good with being behind. If I'm ahead, I can get momentum. I can stay excited. You know, I'm ahead. I start getting behind. I start getting overwhelmed. I just get further and further behind. So I'm glad I've got a beginning of a new year in front of me. And then right in the middle of that thing, I've got a birthday when I start getting behind that I can start all over. And so that's the way I use that. And I try to stay ahead of things there. But the fact is, folks, that, you know, serving the Lord, and I'm not trying to sound pious to you tonight. I'm trying to be honest with you. Serving the Lord is not a burden to me. It's not. I'm living proof that where sin abounded, grace did much more abound. I was lost, now I'm found. I was blind, now I see. I do love Him. It's not a chore for me to talk about the Bible to folks. I promise you, it's not a heaviness. When I'm talking to somebody about the Word of God, I'm at home. I love it. It's not hard for me to brag on Jesus. You understand? Witness to a neighbor, witness to a friend, witness to a stranger, I can brag on Jesus Christ. That's not hard at all. That's not uncomfortable. It's not inconvenient at all. Amen. It may be for them. And I may get cut down, shut down, whatever, shot down. And that may be hard. But talking about Him's not hard. Talking about the Bible's not hard. Going to church isn't hard. Praying's not hard. I love to serve the Lord. And I say all that to say this, friend, I have no plans. I'm organizing myself for the next year. I've got no plans. Wrote down on a certain day, I'm going to miss church there. I'm not going to read my Bible on that day. I'm not going to be praying then. I'm going to take a week off from witnessing. I've got no plans of ever backing out of this thing. None. None. 52 weeks, amen. 365 days. I want to be on the same page with the Lord. That's my heart's desire. But I'm not so foolish to know as to fail to recognize that it just takes just one bad turn on a certain day. And the whole year is a disaster. And that's what happened to David. And the Bible tells us, the Holy Spirit goes out of His way to tell us when that thing got off track. He shows us that it's when that year it has expired. He's facing a brand new year. And when it's so important to get a good start, David didn't get a good start. He's out of place and he's out of character. Certainly, he's an example to us in a lot of scenarios. The Holy Spirit uses him. Whether he's loved or hated and despised and rejected or accepted and loved, popular, whatever, he's one that's an example to us. David is. And here, in a situation of carnality, David is the man that slays a giant. But here, he's slain by a giant. It's called the giant of lust, the giant of sin. And as most people think of the life of David, those are the two highlights of his life, like it or not. One is he destroys the giant, and there's a lot of other people that know him because of the way he messed up with Bathsheba. And those are the two events of his life. And there's a lot more to him than just those two things, actually. But that's the way it happens. You know, you can do right 1,000 times and no one ever mention it once. You can do wrong once and they may hear about it 1,000 times. And that's the way this thing goes with David. He committed adultery with Bathsheba. He committed adultery. David did. It's amazing. Then he begins to cover this thing up. A conspiracy. It leads to murder. Somebody gets killed because he's trying to cover his tracks. Somebody loses their life. And then he swoons in there after they're gone and just takes her in. And sort of, if you didn't know what happened, he looks like a hero. He even looks good doing what he's doing. Grieving widow, her husband's gone, she's mourning for him. He's gone, her days of mourning is over. He comes in there and takes her to wife. It looks like the good guy, when actually we know he's the perpetrator behind it all. The Bible says that he had, at a time when kings went forth to battle, David tarried still at Jerusalem. It says it came to pass at evening tide that David arose from off his bed, walked upon the roof of the king's house, and from the roof he saw a woman washing herself, and the woman was very beautiful to look upon. David sent and inquired after the woman, and one said, "Is not this Bathsheba, the daughter of Eliam, the wife of Uriah the Hittite?" Lord, you know who that is. And David sent messengers and took her. And she came in unto him, and he lay with her, for she was purified from her uncleanness, and she returned into her house. Now some time passes, the woman conceived, and sent and told David and said, "I am with child." Now there's trouble. Now, what's the trouble? You see, that's the way people, now what? No, it's when he stayed back and he's looking up there at that woman from his roof. That's when we ought to be going, whew. Not when she says, "Hey, I have a child now. I'm with child." That's not when the eyes ought to raise. It's when he's doing what he's doing. Amen. Amen. It's not when he got caught. It's when he was guilty. The two factors that lead to David's sin of adultery is lust, obviously. And then, I don't know if laziness would work, because he doesn't seem to be lazy, but he's awful restless. Amen. I mean, the Holy Spirit tells us he rises up off of his bed. He's walking around. He's supposed to be somewhere else. There's something else he's supposed to be doing. So obviously he's restless, bored, like a man surfing the internet at night. Amen. Going through the channels, amen, on some of those pay-per-view channels. And if that hits a nerve, I'm trying to. Not to embarrass you, I'm just saying, hey, sin is accessible, and you and me, we're no David. Amen. But we can mess up just like he did. Amen. See something that we shouldn't have seen, and it makes such an imprint on our mind and our heart that it just causes us to waste a year if we're not careful. Get off track in our closeness with the Lord for a year. The Bible says this, Romans 13:13, "Let us walk honestly as in the day, not in rioting and drunkenness, not in chambering and wantonness, not in strife and envying, but put ye on the Lord Jesus Christ, and make no provision for the flesh to fulfill the lust thereof." It's out of character to think David is lusty or lazy, but that's the way he appears. He seeing Bathsheba because he's not where he's supposed to be, and he lusts after her. The Holy Spirit again points out he rose from his bed. Here David is a saint, but he's not acting like a saint. He's acting like a sinner because he is one. Amen. That's a great lesson to learn. David was a saint and a sinner, just like you and me. He's a saint and a sinner. Complex. We're New Testament Christians. A little bit different than David. I understand that. But there's that old flesh just the same. And we got to respect it, not in the sense that we're awed by it, but in the sense that we know you give that flesh its way, and it can cause all kinds of havoc in the life. And we better be doubly careful. If it got to David, it sure will get to us if we flirt with it. Now, there's the sin of adultery, and as I said, it becomes the sin of deceit. And the natural reaction to our sin is to try to cover it up. More than the fear of God, a lot of times there's the fear of man and what men will think. And so David's trying to make sure no one thinks any the less of him there. And he's covering it up, and he uses deceit. It leads to a bloody cover-up, because basically he throws a battle here without getting into all the details. He sends the letter to Joab because he can't get Uriah to go back home to his wife, because Uriah can't go home and act like nothing's wrong when he's got troops in the field. And he will not go home and act like nothing's wrong. And so David's trying to cover everything up, and he can't. So he sends a letter by Uriah to Joab that basically says, go right into a hairy situation and back away from Uriah. And they may win this whole engagement overall, but they lose that battle right there. They pull away from him. David throws a battle. Here's a guy that was just talking to Uriah going, how's the battle going, Uriah? He didn't care. He's just looking pious, saying the right things, asking the right questions. It's all part of that cover. It's all part of that cover-up. The fact is, all he's thinking of is, how do I get away with what I've done? How do I keep from getting exposed here? See, sin will warp your mind. It'll get your mind off of God and on your problem and how to cover up and how to keep from being exposed and all that junk. The Bible says there in verse 26, and when the wife of Uriah heard that Uriah, her husband, was dead, she mourned for her husband. No doubt her sin cost her too. And it says in verse 27, when the mourning was past, David sent and fetched her to his house, and she became his wife and bare him a son. If it stopped right there, you'd think, well, end of story. Whew, he escaped one. But then it says, but the thing that David had done displeased the Lord. David, again, he's defeated by the sin of lust here. The first giant he takes down is Goliath by name, but amen, this situation right here is really, it's something that David is created himself. This is bigger than Goliath. It's hard for us to understand. This monster that he is dealing with now is bigger than a 9'9" man of war from his youth. He's larger, he's stronger. And David has fed him and raised him and prepared him. You know what I'm talking about? He's created this problem. David, what we can see is long before this failure and collapse in his character, David has become indulgent. He's become indulgent. Indulgence makes us weak. Over in Deuteronomy, the king was not to multiply to himself horses and wives and gold and silver out of Egypt. No doubt, for doctrinal reasons, God shows us out of Egypt because that's important. Stay away from Egypt. That's what he's saying. Don't go to Egypt. Picture the world. But he was telling him, hey, you don't even need to multiply to yourself gold and silver and wives and horses from there, because it'd make you weak. See, when you start doing that, this is what happened with Solomon. You remember that Solomon, there's a course in his life where everything's about building the house of God. And as long as that was the motive, he was on track. But then the house of God is built, and everything was about building his own house. And then he multiplies to himself gold and silver and all those kind of things. Well, what David was doing wasn't going to Egypt for all this, but he was multiplying to himself wives. And he was in a setting where nobody was going to look twice at him, folks. I know that's hard to believe, women, but that's the way it was. David had a bunch of wives and nobody even gave it a second look. If he wanted more, he could have got more. And nobody would have questioned him. I mean, here's a guy with a bunch of wives. Imagine how Bathsheba felt the morning after. And all she had was Uriah before. And when Nathan talks about the situation, he talks about that one ewe lamb. Uriah loved her. The morning after, she's there, and she's not even the only woman there. I mean, mind, things have changed. You understand? Indulgence. This is what David's doing. And in doing this, amen, he is weakening himself. His strongest opposition, stronger than a lion, because he beat the lion. Stronger than a bear, he beat the bear. Stronger than Goliath. Stronger than Saul, stronger than the Philistines, stronger than the Amalekites, stronger than Absalom, Abner and Amasa. Stronger than all those is that sin of lust he's cultivating within himself. Because that's the one that got him. That's the giant that took him down. He kept yielding, giving it what it wants, and then finally it wanted something that he wasn't allowed to have, and he didn't care. He didn't care what anybody thought about it. And he gets a visit from Nathan the preacher. Amen. And Nathan's going to use a hypothetical situation. Talk to him about what's happened in the way of a sermon illustration. Without getting into all of it, the hypothetical situation involves that one man that has the ewe lamb, and over here's another man with this farms and all these animals, and instead of sacrificing for his visitors that were there for a temporary moment, he goes and takes this one man's ewe lamb from him. And he tells this hypothetical situation to David. And when David hears this abuse of power and abuse of riches by this man concerning this one ewe lamb, he is furious. He cannot believe someone has acted like this. He's losing it. He can't believe someone has mistreated someone like this. You ever known anybody that was guilty of something and yet so hard on everyone else? You ever run into anybody like that? I have. I'll tell you, when the last time I ran into someone like that, before services tonight, I went in the bathroom back here, and before I walked through here, I looked in the mirror, and there was a guy. He did everything I was doing. Every time I moved, he moved, and that guy right there, he's just like that. He just, matter of fact, he has a tendency to be hard on folks because he knows that monster in himself. And this is not a long way of me, amen, this is not a long way of me trying to confess to anything. I know how people think today. People watch so much television, their mind's in the gutter. Amen. I've been faithful to my wife, amen. Amen. I hadn't killed anybody. I'm just saying that we, a lot of times, we know what's in us and we see it in other people and we're hard on them. And David was too. David looked at that situation. He began to tell what needed to happen in regards to that man that abused his power and his wealth. And he began to just go after him. And Nathan, as mad as David was, I imagine Nathan pretty brokenhearted. You can imagine how Nathan thought about David. Here's a man after God's own heart. If anybody else, and there were plenty that knew it, but if anybody knew it, Nathan the prophet knew it. And when David has collapsed the way he has, and Nathan has to take in the news as to what's happened and how God has reproved him for what he's done, he says, "Thou art the man. Thou art the man." And you can imagine what a revelation that was to David. He's not been himself for the longest time. Out of place, out of character. And here's the preacher saying, "We're talking about you, David. The one you're mad at. Only it's not a ewe lamb. It's someone's wife. It's someone's family. You've disrespected yourself. You've disrespected the kingdom. You've disrespected your family. You disrespected her. You disrespected her family. You're the man." What a situation for this man after God's own heart to have to realize, "I am the man." He's been covering up for so long that when finally the Word of God comes out and that sword just rips away all the mask and all the covers and exposes him, he has to realize, "I am the man." I mean, at least 12 months has gone by. At least. You can do the math. I mean, the year has expired and he has this adulterous affair. She gets with child. She carries the child. The child gets sick. We don't know how long. Uriah's killed. There's a time of mourning. He goes in and you understand all that. I mean, I don't know how long it was before the sweet psalmist of Israel, you know, how long it had been since he had been singing the praises of God. Whatever it was, it only adds to that approximate 12-month period of broken trust, broken fellowship, and shame. David's sin that he had fostered through indulgence, when given the opportunity, ensnared his mind. That's what it does. Sin messes up our thoughts. What God wants, what's right, what's safe. See, David's, he's not thinking about anybody but himself. That's not like David. He's out of character. There's a time there where he said, I wish I had something to drink from the well of Bethlehem, you know, right? Those men risked their lives to get him a drink from the well of Bethlehem, and he won't drink it. Because he realized it was in the peril of those men's lives, they went and got him a drink of water. He's not going to misuse anybody. He's not going to abuse anybody. He's very thoughtful of others. That's his character. But when sin got in, he didn't care about anybody else. He cared about himself. He was only interested in himself. Every man, when he's tempted, is drawn away of his own lust and enticed. David seen things he shouldn't have seen, and those thoughts got going. Ensnared his mind, captured his thoughts. His sin, cultivated by the power of indulgence, had the power to erase his reason. Not only is he not thinking about anybody else, he's just not thinking. There's no thoughts. There's no thoughts there. He's a practical atheist at this point. Oh, you wouldn't have been able to tell him that, but he's living as if there's no God who's watching. Because that's what sin does to us. You give it its way, and it gets a hold of you. I say it all the time in wall builders. There's sin, and you reach for it, and it reaches right back. And when you're trying to let go of it, it's still got you. Amen. And that's what happens to David. He's in quicksand. This sin that he had cultivated had the power to eclipse his God. Like I said, the fear of God is gone. The giant of lust has blinded him so that he's not thinking about the kingdom. He's not thinking about Uriah, a faithful soldier. He's not thinking about the battle and how goes the battle. He's not thinking about God. Just what he wants and how do I get out of this mess I made for myself. That's David. The Bible says stolen waters are sweet and bread eaten in secret is pleasant. David paid for his moment of pleasure with a lifetime of pain. And we won't go into all the different things that had to happen, but the consequences of David's sin are great. So many things he had to suffer through there that his family had to suffer through because of how he started that year. A bad year. Bad year. Didn't ruin him, amen. I mean, he just, a bad year. He wishes that wouldn't happen. It's a bad year. It was a bad start to that bad year. He ended up taking a wrong turn, and the sword, Nathan said, it'll never depart from your house now, David. Everything's right. All right, between you and the Lord, it's right. And it was. But there are consequences to sin, friends. God will forgive you, but there are consequences to doing wrong. Father couldn't get his son to tell the truth. No matter what he did, son's always lying. He'd spank him and punish him different ways. Couldn't get him to quit lying. And one day, just to teach him an object lesson, he said, every lie you tell, son, he said, we're going to walk out there in that fence and we're going to nail a nail. And he nailed it up, and pretty soon that fence there, the fence post there, the entry of the post, was covered in nails. He said, look at that. Son said, oh, well, I don't know what to do about it. He said, well, listen, every time you tell the truth, we'll pull one out. So his son began to own up to things, and sure enough, would tell the truth, and he'd pull that nail out. And after they were all gone, his son was just rubbing over it where all those nails were. And he said, see, son, God forgives you of all your sin. And the boy said, yeah, but look what a mess it's made. That's the truth. That's the way it goes. Man is abusive to his wife. You know, she may forgive him, but he can't get mad at her every time she flinches when he raises his hand. There are consequences. You understand? There are consequences to our sin. A dark cloud hangs over the kingdom from that day on. It didn't have to be there. He found himself, David did, in a place he thought he would never be. He was the man. Now here's the advice, friends. Listen, this is a brand new year. 2015 is a brand new year. 365 days. Here's what I'd advise. Make plans on serving Jesus Christ. Make plans on getting in that book. Make plans on being His witness. Like I said a minute ago, it's not a chore. It's not a chore for you to tell people about Jesus Christ. That's not hard. It's not hard for you to be at church. That's not a hard thing. But reasonable service, I mean, really, what has the Lord ever asked of you to do that was greater than you could do? Amen. I mean, some Christians go the second mile. Some folks they went out there. They put their neck out. But we were just talking about us here. And you know what? You've got a book in your hand. It's the Word of God. That's not a bad thing to read. You got the ear of God. You can kneel and pray and God will listen. It's not a tough thing to pray. You got people out there that are groping in darkness looking for answers and you've got them. It's not a bad thing to witness. You can give them a track. You got extra money rather than blowing it on something at McDonald's, you could put it in the missions. A dollar here will go a lot farther than it will at McDonald's. It'll go to that missionary brother. Let me tell you something. It'll help him. It'll help him. God will bless what you give, and you can't outgive the Lord. That's amen right there. But the fact is, friends, listen. It pays to serve Jesus Christ. And I hope your plans are to serve Him this year. This may be the last year. Boy, I hope it is. I do. I hope it is. But if it's not, I hope you got no plans of serving the flesh. I'm not saying you won't occasionally fail, but I hope you got no plans of it. David made plans. David made plans. He stayed behind on purpose. And he rose up off his bed that night walking around looking for wrong to get into. And he got in that trap and he never got out. All things were right between him and the Lord, but the sword never departed off of his house. It's good God's so forgiving and merciful. But sin's a hammer. It comes in, it does its damage. And that spot's sore from that point on. I'm just trying to warn you. Amen. We all got a brand new year in front of us. God makes all things new. And He's giving you a new year. Let's stand for prayer.